brought to you by Penguin.
House of Styx by Derek Kunsken. Read by Justine Eyre. 1. March 1st, 2255 CE, 45 kilometers above the surface of Venus.
"We might still be able to patch it," Pascal's father said in French over the radio.
Distant lightning squawked in the radio band. Drops of sulfuric acid fell on the faceplate of his helmet. Yellow mist surrounded them. Few storms began this deep under the clouds, but a big storm could punch all the way down here.
"I give us 5 minutes," Pascal said. "Maybe 10.
"Give me 1 minute."
A shiver of fear began in Pascal's stomach. They were cutting it close, despite his estimates. Pascal stood on the head of one of the big, cloud-living Venusian plants, what they called a trawler. A bulbous head about 5 meters wide and shaped like a garlic clove contained all the buoyancy of the plant. Beneath it hung a long tail of carbon fiber, ending 40 meters below in a woody weight. The trawlers bobbed through the clouds of Venus and even the hot haze beneath, attracting lightning or collecting static charge with their long carbon cables. Georges Etienne and his children had a dozen trawlers, gathered in a wide herd by adjustable sails they mounted on the heads. They'd grafted additional equipment onto each one, turning each one into a minuscule factory. This one carried tanks and hydrolytic equipment to crack the water out of sulfuric acid. It shouldn't have sunk this deep, but its woody pumps were failing. Even though Pascal could walk across its whole top in 5 stretch steps, it was an island, invaluable to surviving in the clouds, and it would soon vanish.
"Minute," Pascal said.
"Gullies,"
Georges Etienne swore.
"Let's salvage what we can," Pascal said.
The haze was inscrutable. Sunlight glowed spongy orange here, with line of sight faltering after 1,000 meters. A storm could be right beside them and they'd never see it. Lightning squawked in the radio band again, and shortly they heard the rumble.
"Tabarnak,"
Georges Etienne swore again.
"Okay, pass me a rope."
Pascal didn't feel any better than his father about this. They sold oxygen, water, and the heavy metals they collected from the volcanic ash and the lower cloud decks, but they wouldn't have money to buy another trawler, and wild trawlers were hard to domesticate. The loss of this one would just make them that much poorer. Pascal anchored the middle of the rope around the mast at the top of the trailer and lowered one end to Georges Etienne as he began tying the other end to an inflatable bag. The lower end of the rope soon tugged tight, squashing some of the straggly black weeds that colonized the outside of trawlers. Pascal pulled up the rope, lifting a steel tank, slick with a water-repellent, high-pH slime to protect it from the sulfuric acid rain. A flexible pipe came out of his pouch. He fitted one end to the tank and the other to the bag to start inflating it with oxygen. While this went on, he began taking down the sail and untying all the ropes before turning back to pulling up 3 more tanks and a woody container they'd woven themselves out of the walls and resins of old trawlers. They wouldn't have the time to turn the remains of this trawler into anything useful.
"Pa," Pascal said, "you think we got maybe 6 minutes?
The radio squawking of lightning became more persistent.
"Why? What do you think about cutting off the cable?"
"We'd never cut it in time,"
Georges Etienne said.
"Or hold its weight."
"I have 2 extra float bags, Pascal said. "I've got a saw. Let me try."
In his father's silence, static burst 3 more times. Lightning crackled somewhere ahead at their altitude. Was his father doing the same math as Pascal? The time to the storm hitting versus the time needed to cut through the tough carbon fiber cabling versus the loss this trawler represented? His father grunted, his helmet appearing over the edge of the trawler, slick with sulfuric acid. He climbed up, and Pascal gave him a hand. Many acid burns over the years had browned and blackened Pa's survival suit, and patches held it together in dozens of places.
"Give me the tools," Georges Etienne said. "I'll do it. If the storm looks close, you run for the habitat.
I'm stronger, Pa, Pascal said. And faster. Trust me. You fill the float bags and salvage everything else.
His father hefted the dark float bags.
Be careful, Georges Etienne said. And when I say we run.
Oui, Pa,
Pascal said, giving his father one end of a new rope. Pascal scrambled down the side of the trawler, slipping on the slime and mushy plants until he hung from the edge. He had to catch the next footholds by swinging his feet, gripping tight and inching his way down. Brown hanging grasses, dripping with sulfuric acid, colonized the underside of the trawler. He had to find the ropes among them. At the base of the head, he wrapped his legs around the long cable and shimmied down about a meter. He locked his legs and pulled free his saw. He had to be careful with anything sharp. Even a pinprick in his suit could let in a drop of acid. Venus had never been interested in colonists and took every opportunity to shake them from her skirts. Pascal sawed into the sides of the carbon cabling, making notches around which he tied the rope he'd brought down with him. It was still slack.
You can fill the float bags, Pa, he said.
Okay.
A gentle tug started, then a hard pull.
I'm going to cut fast.
Go ahead.
Pascal set the teeth of the saw against the edge of the cable and began cutting. The tree-like trawlers began their lives as sprouts, barely a meter long, dangling from the undersides of their parent plants. Once on their own in the winds, they took electricity from the clouds and carbon dioxide from the atmosphere. Enzymes organized the carbon into nanofilaments and kept the buoyant oxygen in the bulbs. When the weight of the trawlers pulled them too deeply into the atmosphere, the cables stopped growing, while the heads grew bigger and bloated with oxygen. When the buoyancy of the trawlers floated them to colder altitudes, their metabolism slowed, and the inevitable leaking of oxygen eventually sank them back into the middle and lower cloud decks. The trawlers lived slow, elegant lives in bodies that were never quite the same from one day to the next.
Almost done? Georges Etienne asked.
Almost halfway, Pascal grunted, sawing harder.
I inflated another float bag. I hope it holds all the weight.
The clouds ahead of them were backlit blindingly for a moment before thunder shook their bones. The cable creaked, thousands of its filaments cut and curling. The sawing went faster. The weight on the remaining cables strained to tear them. Between his legs, the cable shuddered, and he almost slept.
Are you ready? Pascal asked. Are you ready to jump? His father said. Itching to.
Pascal lay the saw into the cut again. His breath steamed the inside of his faceplate, and the drizzle of sulfuric acid rain stopped. A bad sign. Wind pressed against him. He drew the saw along the strands, and the world suddenly snapped. The head section shot upwards as the cable and bob plunged downward. The cable holding Pascal snapped, and he hung weirdly motionless as bulb and cable vanished from sight. The blow wrenched his shoulder painfully, but he still held the saw. His inner thighs stung, and he was tumbling in the brown-yellow mist, past the cable, already out of sight of where they'd been. His father's voice came through the radio, but only a grunt, prodding him. Pascal pressed the release on his wings, and the spring extended them and started the little jet motor. He suddenly had weight again and swooped up in a wide arc, following the swirl in the gloom where the float sacks and the cable had sunk.
Pa, are you okay? He shouted.
Way,
came the response through the static.
I'm towing the supplies. Where are you?
Pascal grunted unintentionally.
Are you hurt? His father asked.
Pascal pulled his legs up awkwardly as he flew to look at where his legs stung. His survival suit was ripped over his inner thighs, as if someone had dragged claws across them. His blood welled. Not much in this pressure, but acid rain slicked the opening.
Patching my suit, Pascal said, pulling first aid pads from his suit pockets.
The pain got worse. He could tell the pain of a cut from the burn of acid. He felt both. He cracked the seals and pulled out carbon fiber gauze.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.